Thank you very much. So it's a pleasure to be here, and I will try to explain what is neuroproteomics. And this is activities that we are doing at SciLife Lab at KTH campus Solna, another campus, not 100 years yet. So proteomics, first of all, what is proteomics? There are many omics out there. We have had genomics, looking into the DNA, we have had transcriptomics, and we have proteomics, basically analyzing all proteins in a given sample at a given time. And this is very much technology driven, and a lot of development has happened during the last 10 years. And it's really happening fast, and I'm really happy to be a part of that and development. So there are two types of categories when it comes to proteomics. It's either mass spectrometer based or affinity based. And affinity based means that we're utilizing antibodies or proteins, meaning affinity reagents, as a capture to analyze proteins. And that's my topic, to utilize antibodies and proteins. And a lot of the aim in many proteomics projects is directed towards precision medicine. And quite often is the term personalized medicine used. I think the term precision medicine is a bit better, and it's very much exemplified by this picture, where the aim is trying to identify groups or subgroups of individuals, patients in certain diseases, that have a common way of behaving when it comes to the disease, for example. And it's really much then aiming for tailored treatments for specific groups of patients, not necessarily specific individuals. But if you can identify certain subgroups within certain diseases, these could be used, treated, hopefully, in a common way. Which is, for example, also illustrated by this picture. You have a group of patients and try to identify different subgroups. And in order to do that, and there is a lot of activities where you try to identify so-called biomarkers. Biomarkers could be any protein, DNA, molecule, or any other specific measurable molecule or something else, which is then used as an indicator of a certain state of a biological condition. And the word biomarker is really used a lot in scientific publications. There are more than 60,000 scientific publications each year with the word biomarker, which means 160 a day. So that has almost led to that there's a negative tone in the word, because there are so many people using it. And then there's a bit of an overestimation of each finding, how important that is. And in the end, out there in the clinic, in the routine, there are roughly 100 proteins being used as a biomarker today. So there's an enormous potential. I'm trying to illustrate that with this pie. This is what we have. This is perhaps what we could get. But really, the challenge is when this subgrouping and personalized medicine, that's there's a huge individual differences among all of us. Not only between individuals, but also within each disease. I would say that all diseases almost are very heterogeneous. You have different symptoms, you have different rate of progression, you feel different, you act different, and sometimes there are different types of treatment that you can get, but sometimes not. So that is also an important component in the complexity. And in order to overcome these, there are a few things that I think is important, and that's the possibility to analyze many samples. Because by doing big numbers of samples, you have the possibility to get a broader picture of the differences between many individuals. But there is also a need, I think, for the analysis of many targets, for many proteins in our case. Not only looking for one or two or 10, but maybe hundreds. And then what is also very important is the access to large patient material, where Sweden is really good, having all the registers connected to the patient's material, which is then what we utilize together with collaborators at, for example, Karolinska Institute. So in order for us to work within affinity proteomics, we work within the Human Protein Atlas. And maybe you heard Matthias Ullén here in the afternoon talking about the Human Protein Atlas. I will be very brief. But for us, this is really a fantastic resource that has enabled us to utilize all the affinity radians created within the Human Protein Atlas. So this project started 14 years ago now, 2003, by Matthias Ullén, completely funded by Knut and Alice Wallenberg Foundation. And usually say that more than 1,000 person years has been put into this project. So basically more than 100 people for 110 years. And all it boils down to is that there is an open access database. So all data that has been generated is publicly available for everyone. And there's a lot of, the aim is to create antibodies targeting all 20,000 human proteins and to map the expression and localization of these proteins in all cells and tissues. And currently there are more than 25,000 antibodies with data in this database and representing 83% so far of all the proteins. And this is a complete unique effort worldwide. And just as short examples, a lot of the effort within the Human Protein Atlas is based on images in tissues. Where are certain proteins localized, which you can see with the brown staining in many different types of tissues, covering basically all types of organs from head to toe in the human body. There are currently more than 13 million images out there in the database. And this was a paper published in Science in 2015, where also a lot of comparisons was made with RNA sequencing data. So then we are able to compare protein data with RNA data as a way to validate the protein profiling we get with the antibodies. Another really important component of the Human Protein Atlas is the Cell Atlas, and that was the topic for Matthias' talk this afternoon. Where all the proteins are used to stain cells, where we can see which type of subcellular organelles are being stained. The green part is the antibodies in this case, where we have the blue as the nuclei, for example. So here we can really get information on where are all proteins expressed in all cells. And also this, a paper by many people, Matthias and Emma Lundberg not at least, published in Science this spring. So this is really a mapping and catalogization of all the proteins. But what we are using, we are not using tissues or cells. We are using body fluids, plasma, serum, and CSF, cerebrospinal fluid. And what is really the key thing for us is that we have 40,000 mass spectrometer verified antigens, protein fragments, and roughly 50,000 protein array verified antibodies. So these numbers are completely unique, and that's what we are really able to utilize. And so in this project, a lot of protein fragments are designed, and usually there are 2, 3, 4 different protein fragments done per protein, and that is then to generate more than one antibody per protein, so we can have them to validate each other. And so we have these affinity radians as one really important component. The other important component is various array-based technologies, where we have developed techniques so we can analyze many samples with many proteins. So this is where we utilize microparticles, color-coded magnetic beads, where we couple all the antibodies to them, so we can have up to 384 different, and we add biotin to the plasma or serum, to the whole protein, And we incubate that, and having those specific proteins being captured, and then we can detect the ID of the bead, meaning the antibody, and then we can see how much is bound. By that, we can actually analyze 380 proteins on 380 samples in a screening mode, utilizing very small amounts. Another important array technology is where we use protein arrays. And here we use small glass microscope slides and put a lot of protein fragments on them, like we have here. And then we have used these to validate the antibodies. And then we can see that they bind what they should. And we use this platform to validate more than 50,000 antibodies throughout the years. What we also have done is to use all fragments that we have generated and put them on one single slide. So here we have 42,000 unique protein fragments on one array. And that is what we are utilizing as a way to do autoimmunity profiling, to see how many of our antibodies we have bind to these specific proteins. And this is something that we regard as the world's largest protein array printed at SciLab Lab. So then we put all these array technologies together. We have the arrays when we do one sample on 42,000 antigens. So this is done as an untargeted screening using spotted antigen microarrays within the field of autoantibody profiling. And then we can use the beads as well here to do a more targeted screening. And then we have the antibodies on the beads, and then we do protein profiling. So either we analyze proteins or we analyze the autoantibodies in these large numbers. And then what is the neuroproteomics? That is what we use to define the different categories that we work within. So we use these technologies to analyze and study these different diseases. For example, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson disease, ALS, frontotemporal dementia, but also various psychiatric disorders and several others associated to the brain. For example, cerebral malaria, which I will actually show an example of soon. So this is one complex slide, but it's one example of what we have done within the autoimmunity profiling that we published last year. So here we identified a protein called anoctamine 2 as an autoimmune target in multiple sclerosis. So this plot here, which you not really can see, but here we were able to analyze more than 2,000 samples, 1,100 controls, and 1,100 multiple sclerosis cases. And in this set, 15% of them were reactive to this autoantigen, and 3% of the controls. So then, of course, the key thing is to can we identify who are these 15%, and why do these 3% of the controls have the same? And then we're trying to analyze what kind of protein it is. It's an ion channel, calcium activated chloride channel, where this is the part, the fragment we have. And then we're trying to analyze in tissues, where is this protein localized, what can we try to learn. We're also trying to get the epitope using smaller peptide to see which part of the protein is bound to. So this is then one example where we really have identified something, but now the key thing is try to understand the biology of this protein. Another example within autoimmunity is where we have studied various samples within psychiatry. There is nothing on the molecular level almost that could be used within psychiatry today. And if there is something that could be used as an indicator, it would of course be tremendously valuable. So this is a project and we are studying samples within obsessive compulsive disorder where patients can really change their behavior overnight, getting into really difficult settings where there's, for example, repeatedly washing, constant counting, etc. Really life-disturbing pattern. So we took a small set of samples here in this set, just 20 or so, and then we started to do the screening. And for one specific antigen, we identified 5 individuals that really stood out. So then the question is, what do these 5 have together? So this is really then something that hopefully in the long run could be an interesting protein if we can identify a common theme or pattern within these 5 individuals. what do they have? So this is then a starting point from a screening. Again, we have one single protein and we have five individuals. What do they have in common? This is very early phase, but we have an interesting target. And we are now following up these with in almost 600 samples with various psychiatric disorders. And all of this is done in collaboration with Uppsala University. Another also very complex picture, but this is summarized a long project in one slide. So this is where we have used protein profiling, utilizing antibodies on the beads. So here we selected brain-enriched genes, and we took 280 proteins from those genes that are overexpressed in the brain, and we analyzed them in different Alzheimer cohorts and in different Parkinson cohorts. So we had quite many samples with quite many analytes. And what came out in the end is that two proteins, neuromodulin and neurogranin, stood out. So these, all these dots is one individual. These are just different categories of patient groups. And what we can see is that there is a higher level in the Alzheimer cases, and also in the early Alzheimer cases, preclinical here. So that is then something that we hope could potentially be used as an indicator for early Alzheimer's disease. But this is, again, something that we just have started to understand in this setting. And we can see, for example, related to Parkinson, that there is no differences in Parkinson, while we can see differences in two different Alzheimer cohorts. And the same for another similar protein. So that's, again, a starting point for an exciting follow-up studies. Another example is where we have analyzed plasma samples from kids with malaria. So we published 3 years ago a story where we have analyzed more than 1,000 proteins in 700 plasma samples from kids in Nigeria. And what came out was that we were able to separate these groups. We had controls, uncomplicated malaria, we had severe malaria, anemia, and we had cerebral malaria. And for example, this group, there are two proteins that we saw a difference between these different groups, which are these two proteins. And if that could be so, that these proteins could be used as an indicator for those kids that come to the clinic with malaria, if they have high risk to develop severe malaria, then they will be kept at the clinic for a few more days. So that small test could make a lot of difference, possibly. But again, it's early phase. I'm sorry. But now we're analyzing in a validation phase 40 proteins in 563 samples, and now they are coming from kids in Rwanda, also in malaria. So this is also something where we are really hoping to be able to understand and explore these possibilities. Can these proteins be used in the clinic? And then to summarize then neuroproteomics, for us it's a matter of being able to analyze many proteins or autoantibodies in many samples, and doing that in different diseases, like in Alzheimer, Parkinson, dementia, ALS, multiple sclerosis, etc. And then we can try to identify similarities and differences, not only within diseases, but also between diseases. To utilize the affinity radiants, the array technologies, and well-characterized samples, and then trying to make biology also after these findings. And then, very finally, and just acknowledge all the people doing all the work in the group. We call it PAP, Protein Arrays and Plasma Profiling, where we have my group, Nilsson Lab, and we have the Schwenk Lab working closely together with them, and then we have all the funding resources enabling all this work. And by that, thank you for your attention.